Hello everyone, I'm ExtraCheesy87 and this is Let's Play Persona 4 Arena Part 20. In the previous video we started Mitsy's story and we're about to go enter into the TV world. We're not quite there yet. A few things to mention: it's been a while since I recorded the last video. I think this is approximately where we were because I had to stop before a bookmark, so I had to try and get back here manually. Also, the audio's been fixed, finally. If anything, actually, the volume is now on the side of things being too damn loud. When I launched the game, it like fucking blew my ears out because I was like, holy shit, it's so loud now. Which is a better problem to have because it's easier to adjust down audio than it is to adjust up, because if you put it at max and it's still really quiet, well, there's nothing really you can do. But I was able to, you know, just turn down the audio a lot, and so it should be a more balanced. It doesn't really affect the recordings because I edit the audio balance anyway, but maybe it'll be less work for you manually. It is also nice that this happened the day after I finished the Cold Steel 3 Let's Play, because I've been having to set my OBS recordings to like no volume reduction, which for this game results in the audio being, you know, you can barely hear it. And for the Cold Steel game, it results in the audio being so damn loud you can't hear anything before editing, which is just kind of humorous that the issue basically gets fixed the day after I finish that Let's Play and I don't have to worry about it anymore, because I'm just probably going to record this for the next few days and try and finish it, or at least get close to finishing it. I guess that's also what I wanted to segue into, is that now we should have more consistent uploads of the series. We should maybe be back to daily uploads now that I don't have the rush to finish the Cold Steel Let's Play, and there's a healthy backlog on that for a little bit. He sits and does not even wait until the door is closed before getting to the point.
I found out quite a bit regarding the case you had me look into. First, I reviewed the report on the incidents from last year. One of the suspects mentioned the word persona.
So what went on here last year?
It's probably related, but I wasn't done there. Parts of this guy's testimony were even more outlandish.
Yeah, something about TVs, man.
What's in the record at face value, it seems persona users can enter TVs within the Inaba region.
It's such a weird plot point.
Enter TVs? What does that mean?
Also, why is it just in this one specific region?
Just what it sounds like. You physically stick your body into the screen and go inside. He claimed there was another world in the TV, and dropping people inside it was the method behind last year's murders.
This all sounds rather absurd. I'm surprised it was included in the police report.
It's like, I mean, they explain how the protagonists and them get the ability to enter into the TVs, but they never really address, yo, why the TV's a portal to another world. And I think the more they don't address it actually just makes it funnier.
I got in touch with the detective in charge at the time and said the same thing. Apparently the report was filed by a young partner of his at the time. He'd entertained the wildest testimonies like this one.
He sounds like quite the oddball.
If this was what really went on, the police would have had no chance cracking it. But that Detective Dojima is one shrewd guy. Even with all the supernatural hocus-pocus surrounding the case, he caught the culprit.
Yeah, he caught the culprit. He caught the culprit. I had asked him to collect information about the serial murders that occurred in Inaba last year. The shadow operatives aren't public knowledge, so I thought the local police would be more willing to speak with him, but the results surpassed my expectations. Also, like, it's barely serial murder. I mean, it was only two people. I mean, there was technically a third person died, but that was a copycat killing. It doesn't count. I mean, I guess technically, as long as it's more than one, it's a serial murder case, but like, you know, it's the bare minimum. This message brought to you by the Inaba Travel Agency. Though it is slightly frustrating to already run up against something I'm powerless to achieve myself.
That's all I have for you right now. I should be going. I doubt either of us has time to reminisce over the old days. It's funny though. I thought the fighting was over, but you guys surprise me every time I see you.
Thank you very much, Officer Kurosawa. Why don't we at least see you off?
Oh, that's all right. I've got my own car. I doubt my department would appreciate your tastes. If I ever showed up for work in something like this, I'd be the talk of the force until the day I retired.
Detective Kurosawa jokes with us before exiting the limousine, waving casually back at us. I had nothing to say to that as I watched him leave, rotating his shoulders to work out some kinks. Aegis, though, felt the need to comment. Go on, get him, Aegis.
Mitsuru-san, this could be bad. Our sense of social aptitude is in question.
I can't deny that.
What should we do now?
That whole exchange about the... Oh no, they seem to have found us despite this not being the designated meeting spot is so good.
Yes. First, we'll need to test the claim that Persona users can enter TVs.
You're at a junkyard after all, and I can see a number of consumer electronics that have been discarded illegally. Aegis looks around and points at a certain pile as she gets out of the car.
There is a discarded TV over there. If the environment does not matter, we can use it to test the phenomenon.
Wait, Aegis.
Don't worry. I'm just going to touch it.
That's not what I was worried about. Aegis isn't wearing anything like a disguise, and... No, I'm overthinking this. We've already attracted enough attention. Even if we leave now without doing anything, our pictures could still end up on the internet. Let them gossip about the strange people in funny clothes, it'll become some urban legend. My mind made up, I step outside wearing my special equipment. Yeah, special equipment. An entire, extended family of chinchillas died for this. Once Aegis sees I followed her, she gives a small nod and stretches her hand out towards the screen.
Amazing.
Her hand, it's inside the TV screen. But the screen itself seems undamaged. Aegis's hand is swallowed up to her wrist as if she put it into a bucket of water.
Interesting. It's exactly as the police report said. What's it like inside? Do you feel anything?
Not particularly. No, wait a moment. It's the same as mine. It's hard to say definitively since this is my first encounter with it, but I believe this reading is from a personality module.
Does that mean our retrieval target is inside the TV?
Huh. Sounds like fun.
I was wondering when he showed up. I guess he just showed up, right? Because when we saw it as Naoto, they were already all together. That voice from above sounds very familiar. Yeah, at least he's kind of wearing a shirt. Maybe. But all I see in the direction from where it came is a man in an outlandish red cape. I hesitate for a moment. Could it be?
Is that Akihiko?
A man leaps from the stacked tower of TVs like an acrobat.
You didn't show up at the rendezvous point, so I went looking and found you here. This whole TV thing is pretty interesting.
In spite of myself, I bury my face in my palm.
Akihiko, what on earth are you wearing? Just what were you doing overseas?
Didn't I tell you that I was on a training expedition?
Yeah, but, you know...
Don't tell me you came here from the airport like that. Does the concept of keeping a low profile mean nothing to you?
Mitsuru-san, I believe we have lost the right to complain about that.
That's it. I'm never mentioning the subject of our appearance again.
Anyway, we can go inside from that TV, right? What are we waiting for?
Still the same Akihiko. We don't know the situation inside yet, and we'll need a secure means of getting out.
What about a rope?
So what? If we want to get this Labyrinth back, someone has to go inside, right?
Well, that's...
Our target hijacked a plane to throw her into a TV in this town. If we sit on our hands, it's possible we'll be put in serious danger.
Akihiko's right. That's exactly why we've been trying to act as quickly as possible since this case began.
We're different from how we used to be. We made the choice to fight shadows as professionals. That's why I traveled around the world and trained harder than ever.
Yeah, the no shirt 2012 challenge.
Now that something's actually come up, you're hesitating? We agreed to do this. I'm ready to stake my life on the mission.
Recklessly unafraid to state his honest opinion, classic Akihiko. He must understand that this is his role. Certainly there are times when I need such opinions. and it's been a while since he went abroad. I think I can understand his current mindset.
All right. Wait right here. I need to go make a phone call first.
Okay, but make it quick.
He doesn't have to tell me twice. I take out my phone and bring up the contact list. World inside a TV. I don't know what it might be like in there, but I do know someone who could help us out. I was originally going to ask for their help after Labrys was secure, but perhaps the time has come. I don't actually know who they're referring to. Now, I've taken all possible precautions. The rest is a test of our resolve. How do I open the... what does it say again? The world inside the TV, I don't know what it might be like in there, but I do know someone that could help us. Yeah, I don't know. The rest is a test of our resolve. And now we have seen this. I don't know if it's going to show the Naoto thing. Also, okay, so the cutscene audio, it's still a little bit louder than normal.
The other members will wait here.
But it's not nearly as, Actually, no, it's pretty much perfectly fine. I was a little worried that, like, the volume for the normal stuff would be fixed, but the cutscene audio would still be unbelievably loud. But we'll do this again. I just want to see if the Naoto thing still happens, even if you're not on Naoto's storyline. I assume it does, but...
Us three will be plenty. We'll end this in a flash. No
problem. This thing could be a little interesting.
The same as always. Although, we have no idea what might be waiting for us on the other side.
And it has been like over a week since I saw this, so...
This situation... It brings back memories.
Ready!
Like, shouldn't you at least get... at least have the comments... while the rope didn't work, at least it demonstrated... You made some thoughts about what could happen. Yeah, looks like we still get to see now though, so that would be kind of like a little hint, I guess.
Why enter the TV? What's going on?
If you hadn't done Naoto's storyline first. Or guess a little interesting teaser.
Where am I? Is this inside the TV?
I remember being enveloped in a white light, but what came afterwards is unclear. Is this the world inside the TV? Oddly enough, the site before me seems to be the main gate of a school. The name engraved on the entrance plate is...
Yasagami High School. I do recall that name from our map of Inaba. An existing high school has been completely recreated inside the TV?
I then came to a realization. I've encountered something much like this before. It doesn't appear to be much different from reality as far as appearances, but it has that same distinctive, sticky atmosphere. The Labyrinth Tartarus, our battleground 3 years ago. It bears a lot of similarity to this place.
Where are the others?
Akihiko! Aegis!
Being separated won't do anything to further our mission. Perhaps I can use my communicator power, or communication power, to get in touch with them?
I can't reach them through my persona either. This place is highly unusual.
It's still barely functioning, but the noise here is severe. I need to understand this world a little better, and find a quiet place to concentrate. As I check my surroundings again for enemies, I hear the sound of the footsteps. I tense, getting myself ready. When I turn around, a uniformed girl stops, looking at me in bewilderment. I didn't expect to meet someone else here, let alone a seemingly ordinary schoolgirl. Could her age and outfit belay a connection to the theft of Labrys? But once the girl's surprise faded, she still seemed confused with my appearance. It seems that even here in another dimension, people are startled by my attire. Well, you could just like wear something normal. At least her... Actually, you know what? Don't wear anything normal. Do what you want. But, you know. A little weird. For trying to be, you know, not suspicious. At least her reaction allayed my suspicions. People reveal something to themselves when they're caught off guard. Anyone in the act of committing a crime couldn't fake being perplexed so naturally.
Did I surprise you? I suppose my outfit is somewhat unusual.
Yeah, somewhat.
Oh, no.
Why are you here?
Well, I...
A loud cheer suddenly swells, cutting off our conversation. Judging by the sound, I'd guess there's a crowd present here. I look around the area in confusion.
What? Where is that coming from?
Students appear one after another, clearly intrigued to see us here.
What's going on?
Before I can react, an image appears on the monitor, buried beneath the bizarre decorations.
Hello! Hello! This is General Teddy, your benevolent dictator!
And I, Rosette, am your commentator! It's time for the next round in the P-1 Grand Prix! Are you ready to fight?
P-1 Grand Prix? Fight?
Suddenly, on the one in the ridiculous costumes, cue, smoke pours out around us. A spotlight shines from somewhere directly above me. I instinctively raise my arm to shield my eyes from the harsh light. It feels like I'm being displayed for an audience.
And who do we have for Yuki-chan's opponent this time? Ooh, it's a mysterious, beautiful lady! How unexpected!
What?
Teddy, what's wrong?
That's, I guess, because she wasn't supposed to be there.
Do you know that bear?
The monitor showing the costumed General Teddy suddenly fuzzes over with static. Static gets worse and worse. Till an eerie, expressionless bear costume, one that looks as though it forgot how to make facial expressions, appears on screen. The voice is the same as before, but his tone is harsh and mechanical now.
Case 04, unintended intruder. Entering elimination process.
What is that supposed to mean?
What's going on?
As soon as the abnormality registers, I feel a bizarre noise, like something scratching against my whole body. Was that some kind of an attack? It didn't seem to have any effect on me, but the girl standing beside me underwent quite a change.
You! Who do you think you are, showing up alone like this?
Okay, so maybe the whole aspect of everyone, like, I don't know, I guess that maybe means that they weren't supposed to be, like, manipulated ahead of time. It was only because the Persona 3 characters are here that started.
It's no use trying to talk your way out of it. There's nothing to discuss. You don't even try to understand anyone anyway. If you want to wall yourself off from everyone, I'll be happy to end your lonely life here.
The girl's face distorts with hatred as she spits out her words at me, the far cry from her earlier demeanor. It's as if she's a completely different person. And that's not all. Understandably, she seemed not to know me before, but now she speaks as if she does. What is this? Could it be the effect of the noise I sense?
Don't be so smug for long. Come, Konohana Sakuya!
A persona?
The girl spreads the fan in her hand, and with a flash of light, a persona manifests. How careless of me. I should have accounted for this possibility as soon as I saw her here in this world.
We won't be settling this peacefully, I see. In which case...
Ready my evoker and concentrate.
To me, Artemisia.
Power rises from within me, and the sensation of my limbs tells me that my persona has emerged. But my hand holding the evoker is still at my side. My persona, did it just appear without the use of my evoker to trigger it? Did I summon it only by thinking? Theoretically, one doesn't need an evoker to summon one's persona. I didn't have one the day my persona first manifested, and I've done without one several other times as well. But never before have I summoned it so easily and without any special concentration. That's if my consciousness is reaching far beyond the boundaries of my body. By way of analogy, it feels like being able to control the wind with my fingertips. Could it be because this world is special? I wonder if that's maybe has something to do with how they're able to, like, read their inner thoughts and emotions to have them say the dialogue to get them mad, right? Just that phrase, consciousness reaching far beyond the boundaries of my body. The girl's voice brings you back to the situation at hand, which reminds me, the girl doesn't seem to use any special implement to summon either.
A persona user. Fine, I still won't lose.
Sorry, but I won't be defeated either.
Let's not get ahead of ourselves. Alright, Okay, this is a little loud. I think instead of... I don't know why the recording stopped, but for some reason it did. I don't think I hit stop recording, but I think maybe I was when I was trying to turn down my audio, I hit the wrong button. I only just barely noticed that the recording stopped too, because those little like flash in the corner of OBS that was like recording saved, and I just happened to catch it. Oh man, I would have been so mad if I'd recorded the rest of this video. Oh man, how do I play this game? Wait. Okay, you have like no commands, so that's something. Or at least they're simple. What the hell does charge mean? I guess that means hold? And what are the button colors mean again? So that's weak and strong. Okay. Oh god.
Go! You're slow! Marin Karen!
Oh god.
You're slow!
Oh god. What is it? Okay, so it's like a little aerial.
You're slow! Marin Karen!
Oh god, I didn't mean to do that.
You're slow!
And that could have gone worse. Once the battle ends, the monitor nearby switches on.
An irregularity has occurred. Multiple intruders detected. Emergency. Intruders are persona users. Due to difficulties in elimination, they will be acknowledged as valid targets.
He obviously refers to myself and the others. Does he mean that he's going to adjust his tactics for dealing with us, due to how much of a threat we are? The way he said that seems like a bad omen.
Valid targets.
I understand that we're considered to be intruders, but what did he mean by that? It seems we're part of the tournament now, but what was the enemy's original plan? Also, what do you mean, tournament? I mean, I guess they have mentioned the P-1 Grand Prix, but they haven't seen, like, the video or anything, right? The monitor screen fuzzes again. Once more, it shows the costumed person as he originally appeared.
Jeez, you need to let me know if you want to get in on the fun! But this is a unique situation, and you're one hot mama, so I'll make an exception! Just keep putting on a good show in your next bout, too!
Who are you? Why don't you take off that strange costume and show your face?
Hey now, I don't think a lady walking around in a cat suit like yours can talk to me about my bear suit.
I mean, I guess he's got a point.
Enough with the questions. Move on.
Again, yet another person hung up in my outfit. It's unlike me to let the enemy's words get under my skin. Monitor switches off at those cheeky words.
Is that costume thing the one who stole Labrys? If so, then what's the purpose of this bizarre tournament? Fine. I'll get a read on your location.
I quickly link my communicator and persona. Some personas are more suited to operational support than direct combat. In my case, though, that power is secondary. We normally have a persona user who specializes in that role, but with some specialized equipment, I can get by. I focus my consciousness and send it drifting throughout the surrounding area. The enemy must think he's keeping an eye on us, but he'll learn soon enough that he's not the only one with a bird's eye view of the situation. More the layout of this place becomes clear, an unexpected change occurs around me. The moment I use my power, noise runs through the students that have been spectating. In an instant, they turn into something like silhouettes that barely have human shapes. It seems their true colors have been exposed. Are they not human?
What? Were they shadows? If they were, I don't sense any hostility from them. Were they just set dressing that thing in the costume prepared?
A cheering crowd would lead one to believe that there is a large number of people inside the TV, but that doesn't seem to be the case. Which leaves a mystery. It may be best to consider it a blessing.
In any case, it appears that apart from this girl here, none of those students were real.
The girl who had collapsed on the floor is coming around. I release my persona and rush over to help her up. I wasn't fighting to my fullest, so she shouldn't be suffering from any real wounds. Come on, man. Don't dunk on Yukiko like that. Say she got her ass kicked when Mitsuru wasn't even trying? I mean, that probably makes sense. Mitsuru was, like, you know, presented as, like, one of the stronger Persona 3 characters, but... and technically has more experience. There are many mysteries surrounding this girl. She seems to be more than just an associate of the one in the bear costume. The moment the girl sees me, she jumps back like a startled animal. Her speech is flustered, her face a bright blushing red. There are tears in her eyes.
How come you knew about that?
What?
About what?
That was private! I never even told anyone at the inn about that!
I don't want to know.
I can't believe someone I've never even met before knew!
The girl covers her reddened face in shame. I try and think back to what I said to her. Did I point out anything that would cause such a reaction? One detail jumps out at me. When the girl's manner of speech shifted before our battle, it wasn't just her personality that abruptly changed. Though we had just met, she talked as if she knew more than she should about my past.
That reminds me, that noise I sensed earlier is gone.
Yet the girl before me now is no longer bears any of the senseless animosity from before.
It seems to have been some kind of interference from the enemy. Come to think of it, that bear was egging us on. The interference must have been to ensure two total strangers would fight. General Teddy, was it? He looked comical enough, but he certainly put an elaborate scheme in motion.
No! How could Teddy...
He seems to have finally calmed down and continues muttering with a perplexed expression.
You know the one in costume, I take it?
Oh, I know him very well. He's usually not like this at all.
I take the girl's hand and again help her to her feet.
I'm Mitsuru Kirijo. I've come here in search of a unique object. Why don't we start over? If you don't mind, I'd like to hear a little about yourself.
Yes. Oh, my name's Yukiko Amagi. I'm sorry for losing my composure just now.
So, Amagi, why did you come to this world?
Where to start? So many strange things happened over the last year.
At first glance, she looks like an ordinary student, so why is she here inside the TV? Amagi briefly summarized her recent past to me in an even tone of voice. According to her, this world was prominent in a serial murder case last year. She and her friends awakened to their personas while investigating the case and even eventually solved it. This world is formed by people's thoughts, and at the case's conclusion, it returned to its original state. None of this contradicts what I learned from Detective Kurosawa.
A realm inside a TV, formed by people's thoughts. It sounds absurd, but that would explain the incongruity I sensed when I used my persona.
We thought the case had been solved, but lately there's been another strange program on the air. My friends and I couldn't ignore that, so we came back here.
Your friends? Are there others here besides yourself?
Yes, I was with three other people, but we got separated when we entered. The one in costume and the girl who called herself Rosette are friends of ours, too. But they're acting so strangely.
So this is not the way they generally behave, then?
I can tell from Amagi's reaction that normally she trusts these two implicitly. It's so weird to see her referred to as Amagi. Considering what the enemy did to her earlier, could they be under its control as well? Either way, it sheds no light on the theft of Labrys. How are they related? Or is this incident only a coincidence?
There's one more thing I'm curious about. Have you ever heard the name Labrys?
Labrys? No, I don't think I've ever heard of that before. What is it?
It's the thing I'm searching for. What makes it problematic is that I know nothing of its appearance. Honestly, I'm not sure it has anything to do with this disturbance. Though I can't write it off completely as irrelevant.
Though it appears that there is no connection, whoever went so far as to hijack a plane to steal Labrys brought her all the way here. No matter how I look at it, that means something.
Anyway, thank you for your cooperation. I understand the situation better now. We should stay together going forward.
Whoa! Think again, ladies!
General Teddy suddenly appears on the screen to interrupt our conversation.
Only the winner of each bout can go on! Rule number one in the Grand Prix!
How exactly can that rule be enforced? As if to answer my unspoken question, Amagi makes an odd gesture. Her nose? It belongs to us?
There's nothing here, but I can feel something. A wall, maybe? Wait, but Mitsuru-san could...
Amagi looks at me expectantly. I take a tentative step and walk through the place where she claims there's a wall.
Like I said! You're stuck there until the tournament's over! Only winners get to go! Come on, miss! You won! So it's time to barrel forward to the next stage!
That's a good one. I must leave the girl alone in this strange world, then. Though I'm uneasy about doing so. Magi seems to read my thoughts and smiles.
Thank you, but I'll be alright. I fought shadows for an entire year, too. I can protect myself.
I see. In that case, I'll press on and do my best to rescue your friends.
If you see them, please tell them I'm all right and they shouldn't worry about me. You be careful too, Mitsuru-san.
Magi smiles resolutely. She's a very strong
all
girl.
Right. I'll pass that along.
I nod, acknowledging her wishes, and turn my back to walk
Not
away.
Not only do they tamper with our minds, they prevent us from leaving until the tournament is settled. It may not necessarily ruin friendships, but there's no way forward than to fight one another. What a loathsome trick. It seems the mastermind is intent on us fighting each other.
I grit my teeth in anger. Magi's clear eyes remain in my heart. This operation, it's no longer just to retrieve Labrys. I make a silent bow as I go. Everyone who has been dragged into this must be rescued. Don't worry, we got Kanji on the case, man. He's the world's strongest.
Another dead end.
As I step into the school, I realize that these invisible walls are everywhere, blocking off routes that seem open to the naked eye. Why is the thief who stole Labrys gathering Persona users in this world? Not having a clear idea of their motivations is compounding my anxiety. I guess Anakihiko may have been dragged into this Grand Prix as well. If so, I need to compare notes. If all goes well, we may figure out the location of the mastermind behind this that I failed to grasp earlier. After quickly confirming that there are no shadows nearby, I link my communicator with my persona. Focus my consciousness and send it drifting throughout the surrounding area.
Hurts. So lonely.
What was that?
The presence is faint and I can't tell where it is, yet I can definitely hear a voice. Seems I could sense it because of my secondary support capabilities, but when I focus harder, it doesn't seem that they're trying to communicate with me. It's more like the words and intense emotions behind them are seeping out of the room itself, perhaps even from all around me. Eventually, the voice becomes clearer.
I'm scared. And alone. It hurts. Why? Why won't anyone listen?
I don't recognize the voice. Perhaps one of Amagi's friends.
I didn't ask to be born a machine. How come no one understands? What's the difference between normal people's hearts and mine?
A machine? Is that Labrys?
Stand up and try calling to
Labrys,
her.
Labrys! Are you nearby? Answer me!
But there is no answer. It seems that it's not because of the voice owner is nearby that I can sense her. It is subtly different from hearing voices with one's own ears, it's true. I focus my senses once again, but I still can't tell exactly where it's coming from. Not yet having a thorough command of the layout here makes it harder to pinpoint. Eventually the voice fades, only silence remains.
Going by what she said, that had to have been Labrys. Sounds as if her heart has developed further than we thought.
Even I guess the latest model required a lot of time and experience to develop her heart she has. Even so, why does Labrys, who's been sealed from her development up until now, have such an advanced heart?
I didn't ask to be born a machine. It pains me to hear that.
The anti-shadow suppression weapons. Both Aegis and Labrys are created as insurance for dangerous shadow experimentations, in case the subject should go berserk. The only thing that can stand up against a shadow is a persona, and being able to control one is an absolute necessity when dealing with shadows. Thus, they were given hearts in order to induce their ability to use personas. But a weapon that has a heart contradicts itself. It was natural for Aegis to face that contradiction, and it caused her serious anguish in the past.
We can't allow victims like her to be tormented by sins of the past, whether they're human or not.
Newly resolved, I press on. Okay, so we're going to keep going for a little bit longer, but I do need to pause. Be right back. Alright, we're back. I continue through the school, still unable to contact Aegis or Akihiko. I should have checked to see how long the record, because I think we're at like 35 minutes. Because I think the recording was at 20 minutes when I accidentally stopped it. So I think we can still go for another 10 or so minutes maybe. The invisible walls seem to be leading me towards a gym. Compared to the one back at Gekkokan High, this one is rather modest, but okay, yeah, oh, I'm sorry, our schools are rich. But the chairs stacked to unusual heights and the monitors everywhere give it an eerie air. Ah, the monitor is switching on again. But this time it's not showing General Teddy. How strange, this appears to be a commercial for a fighting event.
What in the...
A succession of young men and women are introduced as participants. One of them I recognize as Amagi.
They're wearing the same uniforms as Amagi. I assume these are the friends she spoke of.
Yeah, I'm kind of glad they didn't show the cutscene again. I didn't have to wonder, like, what if it's different this time? All of them are introduced with horrible epithets, but the Amagi girl I met in person was a completely different, sophisticated girl. I suppose the enemy made up all the taglines. Just as Amagi's introduction ends, the video suddenly turns off, and General Teddy's face appears on screen.
I had to completely rejigger the bracket to accommodate three new contestants! Sheesh!
Three new contestants. Myself, Akihiko, and Aegis?
On the other paw, a tournament's more exciting with more people in it.
That's true.
But getting back on track, allow me to introduce your next opponent.
When I enter, someone who had already been there turns around. His face, it was on the video a moment ago.
Oh, there's people besides us here?
You're...
Holy crap, she's smoking hot. The thing she's wearing doesn't hurt either.
It's been a while since we've had Yosuke on screen.
You were in that video just now. What was it they called you? Captain Ressentiment?
How come you remember that stupid title and not my real name? Figures I need a knockout like this, and she already knows about that. God, I wish I was dead!
Well, she's probably always gonna stab you soon, so maybe it'll come true. Apparently the epithets in the video hit a sore spot with the people featured. Yeah, of course they do. The nickname left more of an impression than his real name, so it just slipped out. Damn. At that moment, General Teddy appears again on one of the larger monitors inside the gym.
How do you like your opponent?
Why are you making us fight? What benefit do you derive from this nonsense?
So many questions. I just want you all to suffer. Isn't that exciting? Isn't that fun?
That's what this is about? No. If Labrys is involved, there's more to it, isn't there?
Enough jibba-jabba! Hurry and start the fight! Look at your opponent! He's ready, see?
As the general smirks, a wave of discomfort washes over me. It's the same as that time of the Magi. As I glare at the monitor, thinking that more interference is at work here, I hear unexpectedly bitter words.
Yeah, Teddy's right. I mean, you're the one who barged in here. Man, Who'd come to such a dangerous place without hesitating? You really are an ice queen. I bet you don't have many friends, huh?
It's happening again. The moment that noise kicks in, not only does my opponent's personality change, they begin speaking of things they shouldn't know about. It's exactly like what happened with Amagi.
You talk as if you know me.
Stop acting so calm and changing the subject. You seem like you don't know much about this world, so how do you plan to get out?
I mean, that's fair.
Don't tell me you rushed in here with no escape plan.
Yeah, you didn't even, like, come up with the Yosuke-patented use-a-rope strategy.
Oh man, seriously? You're nuts! People like you who obsess over responsibility and put all the burden on yourselves, you annoy the hell out of me.
It doesn't matter how others perceive me.
Yeah, that's what I'm talking about. Isn't that because you don't trust anyone?
We clearly can't have a normal conversation with the enemy's interference, but even knowing that, I catch myself trying to argue the point. The heavy responsibility I suffer is mine alone. If I share it with someone, that means that suffering will also be shared. That's why I try to be self-sufficient. The more I care about someone, the less I'm willing to rely on them. But isn't that no better than not believing in them? I've been caught in that trap before. Maybe I still haven't truly escaped it. But how could he guess at my private distress, one that I've barely confided to others before?
I was supposedly an unexpected intruder. What's going on?
What are you mumbling about? Well, let me ease your mind. I'll end everything for you. Let's do this, Jiraiya!
Go, Yosuke-senpai! Beat up that shady lady! Let the fight begin!
I can see there'll be no talking sense with him like this. There's nothing for it, then. Artemisia!
And away we go. Okay, let's try and not end the recording this time, as soon as the fight starts. What all do you do again? Okay. Oh god. My buttons. Oh god. Oh god. The buttons, they do nothing?
You have time to go.
Please not be alive, thank you. That is an outfit she's wearing, man.
Aw, you're so useless, Yosuke-senpai! Unfortunately, the party crasher wins!
That girl in the PA system is rather casual with her insults. Soon after, General Teddy appears on the monitor.
You're so strong, miss! I can barely believe how gorgeous and powerful you are!
It seems they're not provoking us only to have us fight one another. And their method, is it more like an illusion they're casting over us, rather than some sort of mind control?
Still trying to figure everything out? Switch your brain off and enjoy the Grand Prix already!
Sorry, but I'm not some savage who enjoys the suffering of others. And don't call me Miss. My name is Mitsuru Kirijo.
Kirijo?
You've toyed with us, and I don't take that
lightly. They're like,
I'll make you pay for what you've done. You better be prepared for that.
The name makes the eyes change?
Kirijo!
The moment he hears my voice, the face on the bear costume distorts into a mask of hate.
You're the one who should be prepared! I'll never let you stop me!
The broadcast ends after he flings those words at me. I guess we'll go ahead and call it here, because I think we're at about time. Next time, we'll continue on with Mitsy's story. We might be able to go back to daily uploads here, or at the very least every other day. We'll see how it goes, how much I'm able to record the next few days. The very least will be a bit more consistent now, since I don't have, since I have time to kind of not just hyper-focus on finishing the CS3 Let's Play. But yeah, we'll continue onward in the next video. I'm ExtraCheesy87, stay tuned for the next part, and bye guys.